Thank
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity. So I just recently moved to Doylestown with my wife and my daughter. So that was the reason why I want to get more involved with BCAR. But as a mortgage broker, I've been in the mortgage business for about 15 years now almost, and I work with a lot of different lenders. So we have access to all pretty much residential programs that are out there. We have access to the regular conventional FHA, USDA, VA loans. Also, we have access to non-traditional loans such as the DSCR loans, bank statement loans, asset utilization loans. So I have a lot of experience, access to pretty much anything that's available out there in terms of residential properties. The rates are extremely, extremely competitive. So if you ever want to have a conversation, just reach out anytime. I'll throw my contact info in the chat, and I'd love to just sit down, chat, and see what we can do. Thank you so much, guys, for the opportunity.
Thanks, Yuri. Yeah, and put your info in the chat. So if anybody is interested, or they can always contact us or go on our website. We do have the affiliate members listed. And Pam, I'm going to throw it over to you now.
Sure. Thanks
Thanks.
so much, Lisa. Well, welcome everyone to one of our great Zoom Power Hours. And today we're going to have a really important talk from Dr. Lisa Sturtevant of Bright MLS. We're fortunate that she was able to fit us into her very, very busy schedule. Dr. Lisa Sturtevant has been involved in research on economic, demographic, and housing market issues for more than 20 years. She currently serves as chief economist with Bright MLS, one of the largest multiple listing services in the country, as we know, currently serving over 100,000 subscribers across six states and the District of Columbia. In her role, she leads research and forecast activities for Bright, serving as a thought leader on the housing market. Prior to her position at Bright MLS, Dr. Sturtevant was chief economist with the Virginia Realtors. She was founder and president of LSA Planning, a housing consulting firm, and she has served in other research capacities at nonprofit organizations and universities. Dr. Sturtevant completed her PhD in public policy from George Mason University, a master's degree in public policy from the University of Maryland, and a BS in mathematical economics from Wake Forest University. Thank you so much for taking time from your busy schedule today to speak with us. And welcome, Dr. Sturtevant.
Thank you. Thank you, Pam, so much, and Lisa and Siobhan and the whole group here at BCAR. It's funny, this idea of taking time out of my busy schedule. This is my favorite part of my job, let me be very clear with you, is this idea of coming on and talking with agents and brokers and local associations. I have a chance to look at a lot of data every day, but I really value the opportunity to come and talk with folks who are actually out there engaged with buyers and sellers because I gain so much insight. So honestly, if you have questions or comments, throw them in the chat or we'll chat afterwards because I'm eager to hear what you're seeing in the market and also eager to hear from you about different kinds of statistics maybe or trends that you would find helpful for us to be tracking so that you can be a resource to your clients. So I'm going to pull my I'm going to pull my slide deck up, and this slide deck is available, will be available afterwards. And you, I'll be very clear, any of the slides, if you find any of them helpful, pull them into your listing presentations, put them on your website, you know, whatever, they're for you to use. And if there's anything else I can be helpful with, let me know. But I do think it's a really challenging time in the market. I think there is, of course, a lot going on in terms of the implementation of the NAR settlement. But aside from that, there's also a lot going on in the market. The housing market is shifting right now, at least according to the data. And I think the conversations that you may be having with buyers and sellers now is changing a little bit. And so having data on the most recent trends, I think, is really helpful. So let's talk about what we're seeing in the Bucks County and the Philadelphia area housing markets. Those are the two markets that I'm sort of going to focus on. I'm going to explain this chart because you're going to see this chart again in a couple of different formats. But basically, this chart is showing on the left Bucks County home sales every month, January through December. And the gray shows kind of where home sales would be between that 2018 and 2023 range. The blue line, which isn't marked with a legend, which I'll correct and send the slides out again. The blue line is 2023. Home sales were at their lowest level in 30 years in 2023. I'm not sure if you guys felt it, but it was definitely nationally the lowest number of home sales that we have had since the 90s. And we expected 2024 to be better. Didn't we all last year at the end of 2023 think 2024 is bound to be better? However, as we know now, mortgage rates remained higher than we expected. The Fed didn't cut rates until just last week or a couple weeks ago. And so we're actually tracking right now home sales that are lower than where we were a year ago. Remember, 30-year low last year, and now we're still tracking lower than we were a year ago. I'm going to give away the ending here. I think the last quarter is going to be weirdly busy in 2024, and I think we are going to end up for the whole year to have more sales than we did a year ago. But in Bucks County, year to date, we're down by 5% in terms of the number of closed sales. The Philly Metro overall is about flat compared to last year. And it really is, I'm glad that we had a lender on to kick us off because mortgage rates is really a big part of the story. Last year or the year before, I would have told you the big constraint was inventory. And while inventory is still a problem, and affordability is a problem, mortgage rates are really sort of the key factor now. We're going to talk more about that. Despite the fact that sales are down, home prices continue to rise, defying expectations, in my opinion. So each line here shows the median sold price each month, starting back in 2018 with the lightest gray, moving all the way up to 2024. You can see home prices are at record highs in Bucks County. Home prices are also up across the Philadelphia metro area. But as you can see, prices tend to be a little bit higher in the county than they are region-wide. Simply the city tends to bring the metro level prices down. Home prices are up 7% year over year, right? That's as mortgage rates were above 7% back earlier this summer. And so what we're seeing is the market has been surprisingly resilient. Repeat buyers, people who are selling a home and buying a home, are able to bring record levels of equity into that home purchase and in essence sort of buying down their monthly payment a little bit. So I think that's been one reason why we've seen such a strong market. But we haven't seen any weakness in home prices in the Philadelphia metro area. You look down here, I'm in the Washington area. You look down here in the Washington, D.C. area, we are seeing a little bit of weakness as affordability is a really big constraint when the median price for a single family home in the close-in suburbs is $1.5 million. So there's like this affordability challenge that some of the higher cost markets are facing where there's an advantage in some of the Philadelphia markets. I mentioned inventory, and inventory has increased in Bucks County and in the Philadelphia metro area for 5 months in a row. That's good news. And people may expect that that means buyers may expect that means there's going to be a lot of inventory for them to choose from. But look at Bucks County. We are still at less than a third of what inventory was back in 2018. So it is still very much a seller's market, and buyers are going to have a little bit more leverage. And there is going to be more to choose from in the market, but it is still a low inventory environment. And I hate to say it, but it's going to be a low inventory environment really for years. There's just structural reasons why we're going to have a low inventory. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. We typically think of between 4 and 6 months of supply as being a balanced market. This is the months of supply at the end of August each year, going back to 2018. We haven't had a balanced market in a really long time by that metric. And you can see in Bucks County at the end of August, there was only 1.6 months of supply. It's funny, I was presenting to a local association and they had 1.6 months of supply and they were like fist bumping. They were so excited to be at 1.6 months of supply. And I think you guys have a similar situation here where inventory has been so limited that any increase feels like a welcome sign for the buyers that you're working with. But it is still a very tight market by traditional measures. And you can see this kind of playing out. So there's a lot going on here. And you can obviously see I'm repeating the same data for Bucks County and then for the metro overall, focusing on Bucks County right now. The light blue line are the number of fresh listings coming onto the market you know, each month. And it's very seasonal. You can see that it goes up and down. The dark blue line is the number of new pendings. That's basically buyers taking those listings off the market. And you can see new pendings sort of outpaced new listings there in 2020 and in parts of 2021. So the reason inventory is increasing is we're seeing the number of new listings coming on the market being a little bit higher than the number of new pendings in the market. And you can see that in the county, but you can see that even more so metro-wide, where new listings are really starting to outpace new pendings, which is why we're starting to see inventory increase. Despite that increase, as I mentioned, the market still does generally favor sellers. This is the average sold to list price ratio. And you can see the blue that over time, since 2021, it's been above 100, meaning that on average, homes are getting above asking price. The county market is much more competitive than the overall metro, where prices are still, sold prices are still coming in above list price on average. Multiple offers are common. Offers over list are still common. It's still a very competitive market, even as the market is moving a little bit more towards balance. Buyers are still in a position where they have to be ready to kind of make the offer and be ready to face competition out there in the market. You can see that in the days on market. I think, you know, people often ask me what a balanced market is. And, you know, we sometimes fall back on that 4 to 6 months of supply. But in my mind, a balanced market is one in which a buyer can take the time they need to make a decision. And so if you look at days on market, it's been creeping up a little bit seasonally. Half of all homes that were sold in Bucks County in August sold in 8 days or less. That is not balanced, in my opinion, particularly if you look back at the historic data, which shows that maybe, you know, 20, 30 days on market is maybe a more typical length of time when buyers can have to decide. We're seeing that pattern across the region, but the market is moving more quickly in Bucks County than it is in many other parts of the Philadelphia metropolitan area, even now. So if we take all of that and sort of look ahead, you know, what can we expect the fall to look like when to date 2024 has been a little bit slower in terms of transactions, home prices continue to rise. Listings are still low, but they're starting to increase. And while buyers may have been feeling the pressure of higher mortgage rates over the summer, we are seeing a little bit of relief in terms of lower rates as we head into the fall. So it's rates is where I want to start with. This is the average rate on a 30-year fixed rate mortgage, according to Freddie Mac, going back to 2018. During the pandemic, rates hit a historic low in early 2021, but then they also hit another historic milestone. They rose faster than they had in four decades, right? And so that's the position that we have been in now, where rates hit close to 8% last year. Interest rates, mortgage rates have been falling since early July. You can see that green line is falling. And that really was in anticipation of the Federal Reserve meeting. They met earlier in September. And the Federal Reserve chairman was really telegraphing that the Fed was going to cut interest rates. The mortgage market really sort of baked in that rate cut. So my point is, I know I talked with some folks who said, well, my buyer's waiting for the Federal Reserve to cut interest rates. Well, the fact of the matter is the mortgage rate that you can get now or even a few weeks ago largely baked in already the anticipated rate cut. The Federal Reserve is likely to cut rates again this year. It is likely to be telegraphed early. So rates will likely continue to fall and a buyer shouldn't feel like they have to wait until Chairman Powell gets up in front of the cameras and says that they're cutting interest rates because they'll probably be already falling. And in fact, we could see rates bump around here a little bit. So this might be a really good time because rates are lower than they've been since early 2023. But it is going to be a challenging market if you are an existing homeowner who holds a very low interest rate. It's also a challenging market if you're a first-time buyer who might be wanting to take advantage of rates now that they're coming down, but are finding that home prices are just making affordability a big challenge. If we look ahead, these are forecasts from a few major national housing organizations who are all forecasting that mortgage rates are going to fall. If you look at the beginning of these lines, all of the forecasts are for mortgage rates to remain above 6% through the end of this year. So I don't know when they did these forecasts, but rates were at 6.09% this past week, according to Freddie Mac. So we could see them dip below 6% by the end of the year. But in general, we're expecting kind of that 6% rate and then rates falling more during 2025 into the fives. Now, there's a couple of, this is not an exact science. Forecasting is hard in the best of circumstances, and this is a very unusual time, to say the least. Mortgage rates could fall faster if economic conditions get worse. Right now, if the unemployment rate rises or if the economy goes into a recession, that would cause interest rates of all types, including mortgage rates, to fall faster. But interest rates could remain higher at the same time. Mortgage rates are dependent on a lot more than just the Federal Reserve. And they're also dependent on the overall economy and also on the demand for mortgages. If we see demand for mortgages increase, we could see lenders raising interest rates in response to that increased demand. If inflation turns around and starts to move higher, we could also see that leading to higher mortgage rates. So the upshot is if you have buyers and sellers who are waiting for mortgage rates to come down, they certainly are likely to fall further. However, there's other things going on in the economy and in the housing market that need to be taken into account. If you look back in May of 2024, the median sold price in Bucks County, according to our data, was $485,000. Interest rates were above 7%. So that meant that home buyer had a monthly payment of about $3,500, back of the envelope math. I made some assumptions, 10% down payment, some assumptions about property taxes. The thing is, even with rates falling nearly a percentage point, because home prices continue to rise, we're not seeing that big benefit in terms of a lower monthly payment. So now the median price in Bucks County is about $500,000. And even with mortgage rates down at 6.1%, the monthly payment is only down by a couple of $100. So even if mortgage rates fall, if home prices continue to rise, then its affordability is still going to be front of mind for buyers who are going to be looking for ways to find homes that fit their budget. On the seller side, as interest rates come down, it may incentivize existing homeowners to list their home for sale, and that'll be good for inventory. But the challenge there is really this rate lock phenomenon, right? So this pie chart, if you look at it, shows the share of existing homeowners and the interest rate that they have. So the orange part, about one quarter of homeowners, so about 22% of homeowners who have a mortgage have an interest rate of less than 3%, right? And so even if rates fall to 5% or 5.5%, which isn't expected until next year, they're still going to have to give up a really low rate and trade it out. And then look at some of the others. We see that 35% of existing homeowners who have a mortgage have a rate between 3 and 4%. And so there will be more sellers who are out there who are incentivized to get into the market when rates fall. For some, the numbers just simply aren't going to work, and they're going to take out a home equity line to do some work on their house, or they're going to stay in their home longer. But the thing that's been really interesting for me to watch is that I don't think this rate lock is going to affect sellers as much as maybe we thought it was. And the reason for that is that, as you all know, buying and selling a home is not only a financial decision, it's also emotional and psychological, and life happens. And so we're seeing that more and more sellers are listing their home for sale simply because life happens. And I'll come back to that in just a minute. Speaking on mortgage rates, though, we do a monthly survey of Bright MLS subscribers who worked with a buyer or seller last month, and we ask them a lot of questions. And if you do get this survey, I think it comes from me, love to get your insights on what you're seeing in the market. About 70% of agents in our market say that they've worked with a buyer who decided to stop looking. And mortgage rates and affordability were the main reasons those buyers stopped looking. You can see mortgage rates too high, along with home prices too high, are the two top reasons why buyers are stopping their home search. So I'm expecting that as rates continue to fall, that's going to bring more buyers into the market who have been sitting on the sidelines because of those high mortgage rates. It works for sellers as well. 30% of the agents we survey said that they've worked with a seller who basically decided they weren't going to list their home for sale. And mortgage rates were also important to them. About 30% said, I decided not to sell my home because I don't want to give up my current very good mortgage rate. So as rates fall, more of those sellers will be incentivized to get into the market. So I think we're going to see both more buyers and more sellers coming into the market this fall. Interestingly, the main reason why homeowners decided not to sell their home was because they couldn't find another home to buy. It's like this vicious cycle, right? If you don't list your home, there won't be another home for someone else to buy. And then, so I think we're going to start to see the inventory loosening up and see more listings coming onto the market. Aside from mortgage rates, which I think are really the big story right now, we also pay a lot of attention to what's going on in the general economy. And, you know, economic conditions have been very strong. And when the economy is good, people feel more confident about doing big things like buying and selling a home. And you can see on the left, the dark blue line shows the U.S. Economy, the number of jobs. And we are back, way back to where we were prior to the pandemic and even earlier, seeing very strong job growth. Similarly, in the Philadelphia metro area, job growth has been very strong, a little bit slower, cooler in the last few months, but still tracking pretty strongly. Unemployment remains very low. There's been an uptick recently in the unemployment rate, but by historic measures, unemployment rate of around 4% is still very low. And we're going to watch that. If we start to see the unemployment rate rise, that may mean that people are starting to feel a little bit less confident about their economic situations and may cool the housing market. But for now, economic conditions seem pretty solid. Affordability is really a major constraint on the market. The orange lines are trends in home prices for Bucks County. The gray lines are trends in home prices for the Philadelphia metro area. The dashed lines are detached homes. So you can see the price for a detached home in Bucks County rose from about $350,000 back in 2018 to, you know, over $500,000 now. And that is true in many parts of the country. And what it means is that buyers are now sometimes having to make trade-offs. Maybe they're looking for a townhome instead of a detached home. Maybe they're willing to look in the condo market. The condo market has a lot more inventory in some markets than the single family market. But across the board, affordability is still going to be something that home buyers are going to grapple with. As I mentioned, inventory has been on the rise, but it's still really low. So the chart on the left shows Philadelphia metro area inventory year over year change. Any lines below 100 means that inventory was shrinking. So inventory was shrinking even before the pandemic, right? And it obviously declined dramatically during the pandemic, but part of that declining inventory is structural and isn't going to change anytime soon. And what I mean by that is there are a large population of baby boomers in particular who are staying in their homes longer, right? And I'm not pointing any fingers, anybody. But there are people who are living in homes that are frankly too big for them, right? And they are staying in their homes. It used to be we stayed in our homes an average of 7 years, and now it's 13 years we stay in our homes. That statistic alone is enough to explain why inventory got so low prior to the pandemic. And until that supply gets freed up, we're going to remain in this relatively low inventory environment for some time. It'll be a demographic change that leads to kind of a freeing up of inventory in a more balanced housing market, but it's probably not until the 2030s that we start to see more of that balance in the market as more of that inventory comes on. And you can see how low we really have been, though, even compared to just 2018. If you look at the number of detached homes available on the market across the metro area, you know, it would have been like 16,000 back in 2018. And now there's less than a quarter of that available on the market. So I'm saying that all just as you talk with your prospective buyers, they are potentially going to benefit from seeing more choices out there, but it is still a very competitive market. So that life happens stuff I was talking about. So you can see, similar to the closed sales chart, this is the number of new listings coming onto the market each month, 2023 sort of record lows. We've started to see in July and August a slight uptick in the number of new listings coming onto the market in the county. And based on our survey data, you know, it really is those life happens events, right? You have two kids, you get a third on the way, that two bedroom house isn't going to work anymore. Or you have aging parents who, you know, need you to move closer. And that's going to facilitate folks who are selling their home. In our survey, we found that 15% of new listings that went on the market this summer were estate sales, where someone was selling for an owner who had passed away. And I never know how to talk about that delicately, but the fact of the matter is there are changes in life circumstances that are facilitating sales. And we are seeing that even despite this rate lock phenomenon, that more people are going to be listing their homes in the months ahead. I also like to just talk about the new construction side of the market. And, you know, while home building has been up in many parts of the country, in the Philadelphia metro area, there was some increase in the number of new single family homes that have been built, but it is still low by historic standards. And we still see that there is an overall shortfall, you know, relative to what is needed by folks out there in the market. So as we move into the end of 2024, I mean, I think there's a few things that I know I'm watching. And the first is consumer confidence. You know, we're going to watch all the economic data. We're going to watch all the mortgage rate data, the job data. But I think it's going to be really interesting to watch how people are feeling. And I say that because there is a big psychological component to this home buying. And we have seen that consumer confidence has been really weak, even when some of the economic data have been pretty strong. And so if people start to feel more confident this fall, then I think that's good for the housing market. And I think it's really something that agents and brokers need to be aware of, that this market is very tricky. People are feeling a little bit of anxiety, either that they missed out or that they're uncertain where the market's going, and recognizing that people really, how can you earn their trust and help them navigate this market? I mentioned affordability. Rates are going to come down. Affordability could improve, but not if home prices continue to rise. And so I think first time and moderate income buyers are still going to have a challenging time in the market. So looking to their agent to help them with strategies in terms of financing, in terms of compromises on, you know, types of homes or locations of homes, in order to make homeownership a reality. It's always important to pay attention to local market conditions, but I think it's more so now than ever. There's a lot of reporting in the media about the national housing market. And as you all know, there's no national housing market. And a lot of what gets reported is kind of skewed by what's going on in Florida or California, and really doesn't reflect the very strong market in the Philadelphia suburbs. And so using Bright's market statistics, using your own data from your brokerage to track what's going on at the neighborhood level, I also think it's going to be really important to look under the hood a little bit. And so we've started tracking things like certainly about price drops. We're seeing a greater increase in the number of sellers who are dropping their home price. But we're also been tracking the share of contracts that have fallen through, because we've started to see that increase a little bit, whether it's because of financing or because of appraisal or home inspection contingencies that now buyers are asking for. So we need to be aware that there may be more contracts that are falling through, that once you get that contract in, it might not be seal the deal. But we're also finding that it's not true for all segments of the market. The high end of the market is actually doing quite well, and it tends to be the more moderate and lower priced points in the market where we're seeing more contracts falling through, which I says to me it's probably a financial thing and a mortgage thing. This life happens versus rate lock. You know, think about those demographic milestones that propel people to list a home or to buy a home. And those things are going to continue to be really important in the market. And then lastly, inventory is still a constraint in the Bucks County market and in most of the Philadelphia metro area. And so watching that sort of difference between the number of new listings coming on and the number of pending contracts in the month, we're also really paying attention to what we're seeing as an increase among some brokerages of keeping listings off the MLS and marketing them privately, which only serves to reduce the inventory that's available to the broadest of the buyer population. And so we're trying to get a handle on how to track inventory when we're seeing shifts in marketing strategies for listings. But those are the things that, that I'm going to watch. When it comes to forecasting, we produced our forecasts back in June, and we will put out our most recent forecasts, our newest forecasts in November. But for the Bright MLS service area, and then for each of our regions, we do a forecast of where home sales will be for 2024. And I do think in the Philly metro area and in the Bright footprint overall, we'll be slightly above where we were last year, again, driven by a surprisingly maybe busy fourth quarter. I have a feeling that that period between Thanksgiving and Christmas, if you've planned on taking a vacation, I think that's going to be a really strangely busy time. I think buyers are going to see rates as low as they've been. I think there's going to be a lot of pent-up demand, and I think there's going to be enough inventory out there to bring more buyers off the sidelines and who are wanting to get into the market before the end of the year. Home prices are expected to rise. I think the Philadelphia market is going to have some of the, and the central PA market, the some of the fastest home price appreciation across the Bright footprint. There is no evidence in any of the data that I'm seeing that we should expect a big wave of foreclosures or a big wave of short sales or home prices to fall. It's just simply the balance between demand and supply is such that home prices should continue to rise. And then I do expect listings to increase more so in some other parts of the region than in the Philadelphia market, but certainly more listings available to buyers now than there were a year ago. And I only expect that to continue as we head into 2025. I just want to make you all aware of all the research that we do, all the monthly reports, the weekly reports. We do monthly webinars. We write brief commentary on some key economic indicators. And then we also do some special studies like our recent quarterly luxury report. And you can find all that at brightmls.com/research. And as always, if you ever have any questions or think, oh, I wonder if Bright can track this, or I've been looking at this trend, please don't hesitate to reach out. I love trying to track down information about the housing market. And as always, our goal is to help you guys be the local resource to your clients and to your colleagues and to your community. So in any way that I can help on the research front, I hope you'll reach out. So Pam and Lisa, I'm going to end there. Happy to take questions, comments, anything.
Right. I don't see anything in the chat. Does anyone else? Does anyone have any questions for Dr. Sturtevant? I have to say that we as staff find that Bright is tremendously responsive, and all of the resources you provide at every turn are just phenomenal. And we do our best to promote them, to get the word out. And this is just another example of that. So we're just so thankful to you. Let me just check the chat. Yuri put his contact info in there. That's great.
Great. And you'll have the slide deck. My email address is at the end. You can also, if you don't remember it, research@brightmls.com will get to me as well. One of the things that I like the best is if somebody's like, if you're sitting with your clients or whatever, and something comes up and you're like, I think there must be a way for me to talk about that trend or that. Reach out, see if it's something that we can put together. We started tracking the contracts falling through because we had a subscriber email me and say, hey, we're seeing this. Can you guys start tracking that? And we're going to start putting out a monthly report at the county level of contracts falling through so we can kind of.
That's really interesting. I think that you know, all of this information is so good for our practitioners out there, because anything they can have to relate to their clients and get the information to their clients so the clients can make an informed decision. It's all wonderful. So again, thank you so much. There will be a slide deck. And I think what we'll do, Lisa Ginsburg, if you don't mind, we're going to send it out after. Or
we're going to send it out after, but we need to get permission to send the recording. So if we don't have permission to send the recording, we'll just send the slide deck, but give it a couple of days till we get permission.
Great.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Anyone else? I guess we're good. Well, yet again, thank you, Dr. Sturtevant,
you.
For your time. And I appreciate everyone showing up today. And keep your eyes on your newsletters for future Zoom Power Hours from BCAR. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Bye. Thanks, Dr. Sturtevant.
Thank you. Later.